I assure you, you will be engaged and entertained by, and walk away with a better understanding of the communications process, having listened to Tom Liu.
Thank you.
Tom?
Okay, hi, good morning. How's everybody doing? All right, you guys sound great already. Thanks so much to FAPS for having me and for Pearson bringing me here. I've been looking forward to this for weeks, been preparing for quite a while. I want to borrow your ears for about 30, 45 seconds, okay? And I'm going to play you something. Listen carefully to this. See if you can relate. Tune in. Oh, what a day already. I wonder if this guy's gonna be any good. He sounds kinda interesting, but I don't know. You never know how these things go. Hey, what time is it anyway? Is this thing gonna start soon? I wonder if the plans are gonna go through this weekend. I don't even know what I'm gonna wear yet. I gotta remember to call Jo back. I can't believe she posted that picture on my Facebook page. What was she thinking? Oh, I gotta return that email to Mary, and I gotta call Fred about the meeting next Thursday. Man, I'm starving already. I just ate. I wonder what time lunch is. Hope it's something good.
Who can relate? Let me see. Tell the truth. Tell the truth. Thank you. Thank you very much. Give yourself a round of applause right now. Thank you for being honest with me. Thank you. I understand. This is where we're at, right? Insert your own details. Okay? We're busy. You're busy. You have a lot going on. You have a lot on your mind. I do too. Everyone in this room does, and everyone outside of here. And so I wanted you to know up front, right off the bat, that I know that. And I appreciate your attention now and for the next half hour, 45 minutes or so as I go through this, and what we're going to talk about today. Today is about tuning in to a frequency. You're all in the communications business. So am I. It doesn't matter if you're on a stage or in a classroom or sitting across the table from your friend or your family, right? We're all in this business of communication. I was reading on the plane, on the way here actually, that it says some latest research, scientists estimate that in an average day, human being will have somewhere in the neighborhood of 70,000 thoughts. I don't know how they measure that exactly, but 70,000 thoughts a day. I played about four or five of them for you on the audio there, and most of you agree that you have something similar going on. Our minds are moving. We got a lot happening. And so if that's true for you and I, it's also true for our students, right? First of all, I'm going to define what these acronyms are that I have. WIIFM, first of all, and the sister broadcast. I call WDIC. You might not know what that one means yet. I'm going to discuss why most people are not tuned into this, which is an interesting dynamic. Your students, other people. Third, we're going to talk about the benefits of you and I as communicators, again, personally and professionally, the benefits to tune into this. And finally, how to apply some of these strategies to get some real-world relevance to your messages. I'm big on that phrase, real world. I like to be real. I like to be honest. A lot of us have to put on faces and shows and posturing a lot of times in different situations. It's necessary sometimes, right? It's life, but I really just want to be honest and real, and I appreciate when people are that way back, so I'm going to try to give that to you here today. So this is what's in it for you today. Oh, these things up here to pay attention. A quote that I love so much, may have heard of this before or seen this one, George Bernard Shaw. The problem with communication is the key word, right? Illusion. That it's been accomplished. We think we're communicating well, and maybe we are at times. But maybe we're not. Are there times when we're not communicating so well? Can we get better? Has the communication been accomplished? What does that mean? That means that not only was it sent, your message, but it was received, but not doesn't end there either. Received in the way that you intended it. That's different. So we're sending, we're receiving, and then receiving with the right intention. How many times has somebody said to you, or you said to somebody, "That's not what I meant. It's not what I meant. You took it all wrong." You send them a message, they received it in a way different from what you intended. Obviously, we have a problem there. So here's what I want to do really quick. Get the blood pumping already, but you guys had a lot of blood pumping already, especially if I said, "Time to go to the bar." Who'd want to go right now? Let me see. Okay, just kidding. I want to ask you this question right here. Let's see if I can get some show of hands. Get some show of hands. Your favorite subject, the bar.
Okay, let me see the bar.
No offense to the non-drinkers. What's your favorite subject? How many would you would say in and around some kind of a history? History? Got some history buffs out there? Love history? Favorite subject? How about math? The mathematicians. Mathematicians, very good. The numbers people, not me. Okay, I'm going to interject a little bit of humor here, so brace yourselves. I was at a restaurant about a week ago. A guy has a t-shirt on, and I couldn't help but notice it. It says, there are three kinds of people in the world. Three kinds of people in the world. Those who are good at math, and those who are not. And it took me a minute to get that. I had to look at his shirt again because I'm not really good at math, so I applaud those of you. Sorry. I was debating whether I was going to tell you that, but I just loved it so much. I'm glad I did now. Math, okay. How about English? How many of the English folks do we have in here? Love English? Good. Okay. Science? Science folks? Ooh, look at all the science people. Yes. All right. Very good. How about the arts? Humanities. Oh, a lot of those folks too. Good stuff. Good stuff. I ask this question every single term or quarter at my school, and every class I teach, online and off, I ask students, what's your favorite subject? And I get a myriad of answers, some like these. I could have put another couple of things on there, though. But what if I suggested to you, as I suggest to them, that those are fine answers, but they're incorrect? Uh-oh, I just made you wrong. What if that's not true, okay? What if I suggest that, based on what we were talking about earlier, that your favorite subject, and mine as well, is you, is me. Now, before you get mad at me, hear me out. Your favorite subject is you. We were talking about it earlier. All these thoughts going on, all of these things happening in your mind, right? All these plans and details and circumstances in and around your life. You're thinking about yourself and things around you more than you're not, I propose, and not in a negative way. So don't get mad at me just yet. I think it's human nature that we're consumed with thoughts about ourselves, ours. And if that's true, at least to some extent for you and I, then it's most likely true for your students. And again, this presents an interesting dynamic when we're in a classroom or anywhere for that matter. I love myself and that's all that matters. Well, maybe not so much, but to a certain extent. Now see, what I always end up doing at this moment is I risk people getting a little upset with me and I get those faces. No, I am not selfish. I am not selfish. And I'm not suggesting selfishness. It's not a critical accusation as much as it is an observation. We're thinking about ourselves. Think about it, okay? People are their own favorite subjects. Your mind is consumed with thoughts about you, right? Your schedule, your time, your plans, your family, your friends, your interests, yourself. Our minds are consumed with thoughts about my stuff, my money, my car, my career, my time, my fun, my life. I mean, right? We're thinking about these things. We have to tend to them because we're responsible. And notice that you're thinking about things that have to do with you. That includes the other people in your life, your family, your friends, that you love and care for deeply just like I do. But it's a little question that has big implications, I believe. Okay? Talk to a man about himself, and he will listen for hours. Benjamin Disraeli, a British statesman back in the 19th century, said this. Talk to a man or a woman, a person, maybe it would be more politically correct today, about him or herself, and he or she will listen for hours. Start asking your students questions about them. Heck, somebody starts asking you questions about you. Oh, well. Now, I know we have different personalities, we have different styles of communication, but we certainly do like to discuss what we're doing, what we're about, how we're feeling about things, and your students do as well. Gonna play you three songs. Listen to all three. Listen carefully to what they are. Name the artist, name the song, and then at the end of all three, what's the theme that all three songs are sort of presenting, okay? So I wanna give you a snippet of each one, and let's see if you can figure out what we're talking about here. Here are the actual three songs I heard, just short snippets of each one. Here's the first one.
Call me out.
Name the song. Paul Simon. You can call me Al. Trivia question here, or extra credit question, teachers. Who's the famous comedian in the video?
Chevy Chase.
Chevy Chase. Wow, you guys are good. 80s group. All right, Chevy Chase, remember, with the saxophone? He's about 20 feet taller than Paul Simon. Good stuff, right? Okay. That's the first song. So we got that one in your head, right? Keep that one in mind. Song number two. You don't know me by now. You don't know me. You will never know me. No, you won't. Okay. Name the song. I'm playing you the chorus, folks. You should have the title. It's right there, okay? If you don't know me by now, Simply Red. Remember that group? The guy with the red hair, the red curly hair, remember? Okay, so that's the second song. Third song of the Three of a Kind radio challenge, if you're still with me. Here's the third song. Pretty simple, right? Don't you forget about me. Name the band.
Simple Minds.
Simple Minds. You guys are rock stars. Very good. Give yourselves a round of applause. Good, good. So, I'm listening to this in the car now back in Wisconsin. And I would not tune in. In fact, I started getting out of range of the station and the station started going out. I pulled over. I needed to finish this. I was committed. I was too far in. I could not stop now. So he's saying to, he's asking us, what are the themes of these three songs? I just heard it. Not too complex, right? You and me, both of those words are in the title of each of those songs. And it's about you, and it's about me, and it's about us, and it's about what we're doing. And if you analyze popular music and go back in history, the majority of songs that are out there have words, the words you and me in them. And the subjects are about love and personal relationships and universal things that relate to you and me. Most people were raised with the belief that it's not polite to talk about yourself. Me equals bad. I was raised that way. Many of you may have been raised that way too. So some of the things I'm saying here might kind of fly in the face of that, right? But here's the thing. We might not be talking about themselves as much, but we're thinking about ourselves, I propose, as we've been establishing here. And we're doing it often, okay? Now, I found this diagram. I love it. Tell me if you love it. Who's the center of the universe according to this diagram? There I am. I like this on here. There's stuff about me here. There's my stuff here. Stuff I hate. That's where you guys are right there. So couple this phenomenon about ourselves, what we're talking about so far, with the fact that we all have very short attention spans. Again, this is science. Researchers have been studying this for years. We have an interesting situation at play. We have short attention spans. And we could argue that in this technology-driven age that we live in, with how fast the information's coming to us, right? Our attention spans are getting even shorter. We think about ourselves more often than we don't. We've been talking about that. Two, we have short attention spans. Now, as communicators, personally and professionally, this represents a significant challenge. Okay, now think about your classes now. Think about your friends, your family. Short attention spans, thinking about ourselves, got a lot going on, 70,000 thoughts. Okay, things are moving along quickly. So here's what we have to do. Everyone's broadcasting this WIIM frequency, is what I'm suggesting. Okay? Whether we're aware of it or not, that's the kicker. Whether aware of it or not. What does it stand for? Many of you already knew. What's in it for me? Think about this. When you're talking with someone, your students, your friends, your family, anybody, whether they're saying it or not, whether implicitly or explicitly, they're thinking, what's in it for me? You're thinking about that right now with me since I've been up here. What's in it for me to listen to this guy? If you got anything good to say, whatever. I'm busy. I got my Facebook, blah, blah, blah. Right? What's in it for me? The sister station. WDIC. What's in it for me and why do I care? I mean, if I tell you something's in it for you, but it's something that you don't care about, you're going to get a good, solid understanding of psychology today. I used to say that, and I would get that look.
Yeah, well.
For half the room that was interested in psychology, that made sense. For the other half, we thought, why do I have to take this? It's just a gen ed. I got to check off my list to get to my real core classes. Right? So I have to make it about them, and I have to make it in a way that they care about. This is my challenge. Okay, this mindset exists with most people in most situations, I propose. So if you and I can make what we do or have to offer to our students about them, psychologically and biologically, our messages are going to be much better received. And we'll likely get what we want in return. So stay with me here as I go along with this model of thinking. Okay, making it about them. Here's the questions we're asking, right? To varying degrees. Insert your own verbiage here. What's in it for me to listen to you? What's in it for me to really consider your point of view? What's in it for me to truly apply what you're saying? This is what our students are asking themselves in our classes. I've done tons of evaluations and surveys post-class. Post-class and at the beginning, and comparing the evaluation, finding out. And the students, in one way, shape, form, or another, are always telling me this. Why do I need to take this class? Why does it matter? How is it going to really affect me in the real world, out there? Besides me just going through my syllabus, how is it going to affect me out there? So I'm constantly trying to answer that question for my students up front. And if I do that, they're going to be more tuned into me, get more out of it, we all win. That's the plan.